morning.
Good morning.
I'm Pastor Ruth Hamilton. I am the interim pastor of Good Shepherd Lutheran Church. Welcome to all of you to the worship of God this morning. In the gospel this morning, Jesus goes to visit his hometown. And we all think that must be a great idea. It doesn't turn out quite the way anybody expected. So we'll talk about that. We're doing announcements at the end, if they're not already in the bulletin. But the one thing I want to remind you of is that next week, I'm going to be installed officially as your interim pastor.
Yay!
I haven't. There will be a representative from the bishop's office here. And we're scurrying around behind the scenes to get everything ready. But the most important thing for you to do is that there's one service next week at 10:30. It's a bit a little later, but at 10:30 we will begin. Everybody will be together, and we will also have a lovely reception together. So one service next week, 10:30. Be there. Don't miss out on the date. Quiet your hearts and get yourselves ready. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy.
Amen.
Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen.
courage you gave the apostles, that we may faithfully witness to your love and peace in every circumstance of life. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
A reading from Ezekiel. A voice said to me, O mortal, stand up on your feet, and I will speak with you. And when he spoke to me, a spirit entered into me and set me on my feet, and I heard him speaking to me. He said to me, mortal, I am sending you to the people of Israel, to a nation of rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their ancestors have transgressed against me to this very day. The descendants are impudent and stubborn. I am sending you to them, and you shall say to them, thus says the Lord God, whether they hear or refuse to hear, for they are a rebellious house, they shall know that there has been a prophet among them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
To you I lift up my eyes, O you who are enthroned in the heavens.
As the eyes of servants look to the hand of their master, as the eyes of a maid to the hand of her mistress, so our eyes look to the Lord our God, until he has mercy upon us.
Have mercy upon us, O Lord, have mercy upon us. For we have had more than enough of contempt.
Our soul has had more than its fill of the scorn of those who are at ease, of the contempt of the proud.
The second reading is from 2 Corinthians. I know a person in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that such a person, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. Was caught up into paradise and heard things that are not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of one, of such a one, I will boast. But on my own behalf, I will not boast. Except of my weaknesses. But if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of the revelations. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. Three times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, I am strong. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about the villages teaching, called the 12, and began to send them out 2 by 2, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on 2 tunics. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave that place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is in on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Who is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? Earlier in the Gospel according to St. Mark, that is the question that the disciples ask after Jesus calms a raging storm on the Sea of Galilee. In the time between that miracle and the events in today's gospel, Jesus has been answering their question by working wonders. From an outcast living in a graveyard, he's transferred demons into a herd of pigs, which rushed into the sea and drowned. He healed a woman who had been hemorrhaging for 12 years. Most spectacularly of all, he revived the young daughter of a synagogue official, raising her from death into life. All of these are amazing deeds of power. So maybe the disciples are beginning to figure out the answer to their question. At any rate, there's no doubt that people are talking about Jesus. Wherever he goes, crowds are following him. People come to him from all over because they have confidence that he can heal whatever is wrong with them. And then Jesus goes home to Nazareth. You might have expected that the people there would have been proud of him. You might think that they would have welcomed him with the first century equivalent of a parade and the keys to the city. At the very least, you might guess that they would be eager to see what Jesus could do for them. But no. What happens is exactly the opposite of what we would expect. The visit begins normally enough. Jesus does in his hometown what he's already done in countless towns. He goes to the synagogue on the Sabbath and begins to teach. Those present are astounded at his wisdom. That, of course, is the usual reaction to Jesus' teaching. But it quickly becomes clear that this time, his teaching is not going to have its usual effect. His neighbors are not going to accept Jesus' authority as a teacher and interpreter of scriptures. They are going to rush out and tell everybody about him. They are not going to ask, as the disciples did, "Who is this?" Now, the people of Nazareth think that they already know the answer to that question. They've known Jesus since he was a boy. So they respond to his teaching after their initial astonishment by getting offended and angry. They say things like, "Who does this Jesus think that he is, telling us what the scriptures mean? Who gave him the right to teach? Why should we listen to him?" Because the people of Nazareth think they know who Jesus is, they refuse to hear his message. They can't receive it with open hearts and open minds. Interestingly enough, this is the second time that Jesus has tried to teach in his hometown. When he had come back before, people started saying that he was crazy. And his family tried to make him shut up and stop embarrassing him. Now Jesus has come home to give Nazareth a second chance. But the result is the same. Now, up to this point in the gospel, the only ones who have objected to Jesus are the devil, the demons that he's been casting out, and some religious officials. So the people of Nazareth are not in very good company. Everyone else had welcomed Jesus and followed him. So I ask you, what's the difference between all these other people and those from Jesus' hometown? Well, the people who flocked to Jesus come because they realize that they need him. They're sick. They've been cast out from their society. They've lost their reason for living. They're afraid they're going to die. They cannot heal themselves, and no one else has been able to help them. So they don't care who Jesus' family is, or where he comes from, or how he received his power. They don't have any preconceived notions about Jesus' identity or authority or what he should be doing. All they know is that they are in need, and Jesus can help them. So they're open to him, eager to hear his words and to receive his gifts. They have faith in Jesus. And Jesus gives them what they ask for and more. He gives them what they really need. In contrast, the people of Nazareth are sure that they know who Jesus really is. He's just Mary's son, a carpenter who went crazy.
we are free. But somewhere along the way, we've gotten lost. That we are far from being whole.
Aren't we more often inclined to say, we're not sick, not us, nothing's wrong here?
And sometimes you and I have trouble believing that Jesus has anything that we really need.
We don't want to listen to Jesus because Jesus might tell us something that we really don't want to hear.
We can be afraid to welcome Jesus into our lives. Because who knows what Jesus would really want us to do? He might ask us to take a risk, to change, to do something new. And that's hard and pretty scary. Often we'd rather just keep Jesus at a distance, in his proper place, in church on Sunday morning, and go on living the rest of our lives the way we want to live them. And just like the people of Nazareth, we think we know Jesus. Most of us have heard about him since childhood. We have certain expectations about who Jesus is and what Jesus has to say. But because of this very familiarity, we may not be really open to hearing all of Jesus' words, or receiving all of his gifts, or doing everything that he tells us to do. When you and I get that closed, Jesus is not able to do all the wonderful things that he wants to do for us. And we can't do all the things that Jesus wants us to do for each other and for the world. We may think that we do not need Jesus. We may believe that we don't have to pay attention to his word or that we don't need to be healed. We may turn a deaf ear to him and close our hearts and minds. But God never gives up on us. Remember that despite his earlier rejection, Jesus had given Nazareth another chance and had come home a second time. And even that time, when the majority of the people wouldn't listen and he could do no deeds of power, St. Mark tells us that there were a few sick people who he healed. Jesus did not give up. He did not call fire and brimstone out of the sky to punish Nazareth. He didn't curse it forever. He sought out the few people who were open to him, and he healed them. So who is this who teaches with authority and works wonders? Who is this who keeps offering second chances and third chances and a million chances? This is Jesus, the Son of God, our Savior, who keeps coming to us and keeps knocking on our doors, who wants to give us the healing, the wholeness, the new lives we really need. Jesus. Jesus who calls us to follow him and to love our neighbors the way he loves us. May we open our doors, welcome Jesus into our lives, and receive his abundant gifts. Amen.
Thank you. crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body,
thank you.
Remembering therefore his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us pray the prayer that our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father.
love the world with your own life. In your name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
The blessing of God, who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever.
Amen.
Creation, for you are the body of Christ.
Thanks be to God.